Random House Audio presents Limitations by Scott Turow. Read for you by Stephen Lang. Few love to hear the sins they love to act. Shakespeare, Pericles, Act 1, Scene 1. Chapter 1, The Argument. May it please the court, booms Jordan Saperstein from the podium. This case must be reversed. Your honors have no choice. Seated behind the elevated walnut bench a few dozen feet away, Judge George Mason suppresses an impulsive wince at Saperstein's excesses. The judge is seldom reluctant to let lawyers know when their claims are unpersuasive, but making faces, as his father warned him as a boy in Virginia long ago, is simply rude. The truth is that George Mason recoils even more from the case, People versus Jacob Warnowitz et al., than from the celebrated attorney beginning his oral argument. Before he was elected to the bench at age 47, George was a criminal defense lawyer, perpetually engrossed by his warring feelings, loathing, amusement, intrigue, envy, about those who broke the rules. Yet from the instant the Court of Appeals docket department randomly assigned him to Warnowitz a few weeks ago, he had been uneasy about the draw. He has found it uncharacteristically difficult to read the briefs or view the record of the trial in the Kindle County Superior Court, where, 19 months ago, the four young defendants were convicted of criminal sexual assault and given the minimum mandatory sentence of 6 years. Now the judge thinks what he has every time the matter has come reluctantly to mind. Hard cases make bad law. As the senior member of the three-judge panel, Judge Mason, in his inky robe, occupies the center spot on the long bench between his two colleagues. Judge Somerset Purefoil, with his time-engraved pecan face and a sponge of white hair, is perhaps more regally handsome now than in his days as a successful soul balladeer. The other judge, Nathan Cole, small and stout, his plump jaws like a croissant beneath his chin, eyes Saperstein from his first words with a dark, merciless look. Beyond the lawyers in the well of the court, the security officers have fit onto the walnut pews as many as possible of the spectators who lined up at the courtroom door. In the front row, the reporters and sketch artists hastily record what they can, while behind them the onlookers, law students, court buffs, friends of the defendants, and supporters of the victim, are now intent after shifting through three civil cases argued before the same panel earlier in the morning. Even the stateliness of the appellate courtroom, with its oxblood pillars of marble rising 2 stories to the vaulted ceiling, and the gilded rococo details on the furnishings, cannot fully dampen the current of high wattage controversy that has long surrounded the Warnowitz case. It has taken on complex meanings to thousands of people who know nothing about the legal principles at stake and not much more about the underlying facts. The victim of the crime is Mindy DeBoyer, although as an alleged rape victim, her name is never used in the frequent public accounts. A little more than 7 years ago, in March 1999, Mindy was 15 and a member of the rowdy throng at a house party for the Glenbrae High School boys' ice hockey team. Earlier that day, Glenbrae finished second in the state. The players were sore from the pounding of 6 games in 6 days and from failing after coming so close to the state title, and the celebration in the home of the team co-captain, Jacob Warnowitz, whose parents had flown off to a wedding in New York, was out of control from the start. Mindy DeBoyer, by her own testimony, got hammered beyond belief on the combination of rum and a pill provided by Warnowitz, and somehow ended up passed out in his room. Warnowitz claimed he had discovered her there and took Mindy's position, like Goldilocks in the bed of one of the three bears, as a proposition. The jury clearly rejected that explanation, probably because Warnowitz also invited 3 other team members to join him in violating the young woman, unconscious and lifeless as a rag doll. Warnowitz captured each assault on videotape, often employing the camera in a grotesque fashion that would startle even a pornographer. The soundtrack, a vile screed from Warnowitz, ended after more than 50 minutes with his warnings to his friends to get Mindy out of there and, "Don't say Jack." When she awoke at about 5 a.m., amid the lingering reek from the empty cans and ashes in the Warnowitz's living room, Mindy DeBoyer had no idea what had occurred. A sexual novice, although not uninitiated, she realized she'd had rough treatment, and she noticed that her skirt was on backwards. Yet she had no memory of any of the night's late events. After sneaking home, she phoned other kids she'd seen at the party, but no one could recall whom Mindy had gone off with. Speaking to her best friend, Vera Hartle, Mindy DeBoyer wondered if she might even have been raped. But she was 15 and not eager to involve an adult or admit where she had been. She healed in her own time and said nothing. And so life marched on. The four boys graduated from high school and went to college, as did Mindy 2.5 years later. Feeling safer with time, Jacob Warnowitz could not resist occasionally entertaining his fraternity brothers with the tape. One freshman pledge, Michael Willits, turned out to be close to the DeBoyer family, and after a lengthy conversation with his sister, he tipped the police, who arrived at the fraternity house with a search warrant. Mindy DeBoyer reviewed the videotape in horror, and Warnowitz and the three other young men were indicted in quick order on January 14, 2003. As George Mason views the case, the principal legal question is the statute of limitations, which under state law would ordinarily bar bringing felony charges more than 3 years after the crime. But the grinding social issue is that Mindy DeBoyer is black. She is well-to-do like the boys who assaulted her, but her parents, a lawyer and an MBA, could not keep from wondering publicly in their initial agitation whether a young white woman would have been treated the same way in Glen Brae, a suburban town to which integration came grudgingly. The racial charges raised the volume in Glen Brae. Families close to the four boys proclaimed that their lives were being ruined long after the fact for a crime from which the victim had not really suffered at the time. They implied that race alone was causing men to be punished for the misdeeds of children. The sharp disputes between neighbors boiled over into the press, where the DeBoyer's views have clearly prevailed. Most accounts portray the defendants as spoiled rich boys who nearly escaped unpunished for a night of bestial fun in the slave cabin, even though not one of the many ugly terms the boys had applied to Mindy on the tape involved any mention of her race. The substantial questions presented by the young men's appeal have allowed them to remain free on bond, and all four, now in their mid-20s, are beside the journalists in the front spectator's row. For now, the fate of each is in the hands of Jordan Saperstein, in a cream suit with heavy black pinstripes, gesticulating often and using his crinkly gray page boy for emphasis. Judge Mason has never fully decoded whatever it is a human being is saying about himself when he sports a hairdo borrowed from Gorgeous George. But Saperstein is what Patrice, George Mason's wife, is apt in her moods to refer to as an LFT, lawyer from television. A Californian, Saperstein first made his name 20 years ago while a law professor at Stanford, with two stunning victories in the U.S. Supreme Court. He has remained a legal celebrity ever since because of his willingness to puff himself into a state of agitation for 30 seconds whenever the red light glows above a TV camera. He is always turning up on CNN, Meet the Press, Court TV, so ubiquitous you half expect him in the background when you video your niece's soccer game. The desperate families of the Glen Brae Four are rumored to have paid him several $100,000 to take on this appeal. With some panels, George supposes that Saperstein's notoriety might be a plus, providing cover for a judge inclined to reverse. But not here. Saperstein's prominence has been a call to combat for George's colleague, Nathan Cole. Cole, who left his position as an esteemed faculty member at Easton Law School to take a 5-year interim appointment on the appellate court, prefers to treat attorneys as if they were his students, exuberantly pummeling them with sly hypothetical questions aimed at undermining their positions. Wags have long called this style of Socratic classroom interrogation the game only one can play, and here too there is no winning with Nathan. The truth is that for Cole, each case, no matter what the actual subject matter, presents the same issue, proving he is the smartest lawyer in the room, or perhaps the universe. George is uncertain where the boundary falls on Nathan's sense of grandeur. If nothing else, with his beer house voice and squinty inquisitorial style, Cole makes good theater, and he tears into Saperstein not long after the lawyer begins his oral argument with a quotation from an exalted legal commentator spiced in turn with the words of the U.S. Supreme Court. The statute of limitations...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.